Good morning. We have already learned about Kepler's third law of planetary motion. Today, we are going to derive it. Bobby, please read Kepler's third law of planetary motion.
Flipping physics.
The square of the orbital period of any planet is proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis of the elliptical orbit. In other words, capital T squared, or period squared, is proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis, or A cubed.
Thank you again, Bobby. To prove Kepler's third law, we start by assuming the planet's orbit is circular. Previously, we have shown that the orbits of all the planets are nearly circular, so this is a reasonable assumption. Bo, start with the free body diagram of all the forces acting on a planet, and then begin solving for the relationship between period and semi-major axis.
The only force that acts on a planet in orbit is the force of gravity from the sun.
And keep solving the problem.
Well, we have a free body diagram, so the net force acting on the planet in the... Well, the planet is moving in a circle, so let's sum the forces in the in direction. That equals force of gravity, and net force equals mass times acceleration in the in direction, which is the centripetal acceleration. Substituting in equations, we have the universal gravitational constant times the mass of the sun times the mass of the planet, all divided by the square of the distance between the center of mass of the sun and the center of mass of the planet. Are we assuming the sun's mass is so much larger than the planet's mass that the planet orbits around the sun, the center of mass of the sun, and not the center of mass of the sun-planet system?
Yes, Bo, it is reasonable to assume all the planets revolve around the center of mass of the sun.
Makes sense. That means the variable r in the force of gravity equation is the radius of the orbit of the planet in this case. Centripetal acceleration equals radius times angular speed squared. The radius in the centripetal acceleration equation this time equals the orbital radius, which is why we can bring radius squared over to the other side of the equation to make it radius cubed, and
everybody brought the mass to the party.
There are two masses. We have to clearly identify which mass we brought with us to the party.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Everybody brought the mass of the planet to the party.
Everybody brought mass.
But I'm not sure where to go from here.
We need to get period in the equation somehow.
We know the magnitude of angular velocity equals change in angular position over change in time, and for one full revolution, the change in time is the period of the orbit, and the angular displacement is 2 pi radians.
Right, so we can substitute that into the equation I got, square everything in the parentheses, and solve for period squared, we get period squared equals the quantity 4 pi squared over Newton's universal gravitational constant times the mass of the sun, all times the radius of the orbit cubed.
And everything in the parentheses is constant, so the square of orbital period is proportional to the cube of the orbital radius.
Very nice, everybody. Thank you.
You are welcome.
Yep. Sure.
I do want to point out that the mass of the planet canceled out of the equation. That means that the mass of the planet does not affect the relationship between the planet's orbital period and semi-major axis. Every object with the same orbital semi-major axis, A, will take the same amount of time to travel around the sun, which is pretty cool.
Absolutely.
Yep, sure.
Mr. P, I do not want to contradict you, but...
Yes, Billy?
You said we were going to prove Kepler's third law. I think we actually only proved it for circular orbits. We did not actually prove it for elliptical orbits, right?
Billy, that is a valid point. We have proved Kepler's third law for circular orbits. However, we have not proved it for elliptical orbits. We do know Kepler's third law is valid for elliptical orbits. However, the proof of that goes beyond the mathematical scope of this class.
Okay, that's a bummer, but thanks.
You are welcome, Billy. I will also point out that while our derivation was for the sun and a planet, Kepler's third law is applicable to any satellite orbiting the sun, like asteroids or comets. Actually, Kepler's third law is applicable to any satellite in orbit around any single star, not just our sun. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.